My name is Laura Ishiguro. I teach in the Department of History and the Asian Canadian and Asian Migration Studies program at the University of British Columbia, Vancouver, which is located on the traditional, ancestral, and unceded territory of the Musqueam people. In this lecture, I'm going to talk about a woman named Kiyo Tanaka Goto, who was born in Japan around 1894. Moved to Canada in 1913, and then spent the rest of her life until her 1982 death in the country's westernmost province of British Columbia. Here, I'll situate key points in her life in the broader context of Japanese Canadian history in order to reflect on how and why she matters in this context, how her story can change our understanding of the community and its past. Throughout her life, Kiyo encountered circumstances, people, situations, structures, and systems that marginalized and discriminated against her on the basis of gender, race, nationality, class, and occupation. Although she couldn't entirely control those circumstances, she responded to them actively and navigated them in strategic ways. By examining these choices, we can gain insights into what broader systems and patterns actually meant for real people and their lived experiences. At the same time, investigating Kiyo's life in the context of Japanese Canadian history also expands our understanding of the community. In contrast to histories that often focus on the Japanese Canadian community in isolation, her story helps to show the importance of intercultural and intercommunity relationships. It also underscores the important, if still under-discussed, place of sex work in Japanese-Canadian history, and more generally illuminates the complex, limited, and diverse possibilities of life for Japanese immigrant women in early to mid-20th century Canada. In Kiyo's case, I'm particularly interested in how she mobilized relationships with men. Although we don't have the evidence to say exactly what all of those relationships entailed or meant to her, they appear to have been variously familial, marital, friendly, commercial, sexual, emotional, and/or intimate in other ways. Through her 1972 oral history interviews, we can catch glimpses of how, at key moments in her life, Kiyo drew on those relationships to carve out forms of power, agency, and possibility in the otherwise limited and limiting circumstances in which she found herself. I want to be clear, her life shouldn't just be understood as reduced to her relationships with men, nor do I mean to suggest that she was necessarily cynically seeking and exploiting those relationships. But rather, my point is that they were an important part of her life, and an important way in which she was able to shape or change her life in big ways or small. Understanding this, in turn, enables a deeper understanding of gender, race, power, and the ways in which intimacy of various forms offered one pathway for Japanese Canadian women to navigate the circumstances of their lives in the early to mid 20th century. There are so many ways that Kiyo's life can illuminate these large arguments, but I want to touch on just four here. The first one's a really basic issue. What do I even call her? This is a practical question for the lecture, but it's also reflective of my larger points too. The very question of naming speaks to the ways that this woman exceeded official practices and cultural expectations in her own lifetime and challenges conventional practices of historians now. The existing primary and secondary sources about her life tell us that she was known by numerous names. Her given name is most commonly identified as Kiyo, but some sources name her as Kyoko, and she also seems to have used an English name, Kay, at times. In line with Japanese and Canadian patriarchal naming systems of the time, her legally recognized surnames would have come from first her father and then her husband. Now, her husband actually had the same surname as her father, so her officially recognized surname at birth was Tanaka, and it remained Tanaka after her marriage. However, this was not the only surname she used. Sometime after she was widowed, she adopted another, Goto. This was the surname of a man she only called in her interview Mr. Goto, a country fellow who helped her in a time of need and eventually became the father of her daughter. Although it was never her legal surname by marriage, and we don't know what all of her understandings of the relationship or her intentions with the name were, I think we can understand Goto as a name that she actively chose in some recognition of a relationship that was important in her life. But all of this leaves me with far too many choices of what to call her. It's most conventional for historians to use surnames only when referring to our subjects. But in this case, instead of calling her Tanaka Goto or the double-barreled Tanaka Goto, I've made the unusual choice to call her Kyo. I do this because I see Kyo as the name she used, or that was used for her comparatively consistently throughout her life, as a name that distinguishes her from others in her life who shared surnames, either assigned or chosen, and as a name that recognizes her individuality, even as her other names changed in relation to shifting circumstances, senses of identity, and relationships with others. For me, grappling with the question of naming and what to call her matters because it's one example of how Kyo's choices in life exceeded simple state categories and cultural expectations, and how the sources she left behind reveal instead her creative, fluid, changing, and sometimes evasive senses of self and relationship. But I want to give you some more concrete examples from her life too. So I'll turn to the first of those now, the story of her marriage and migration. Kyo was born in Tokyo around 1894. When she was still a young child, her father moved to the United States, leaving behind two younger siblings and their mother. She grew up in poverty in Kyushu. When she was 19 years old, her neighbors helped to organize a marriage to a man she'd never met, Tetsu Tanaka. Leaving behind a different fiancé, a doctor, in Japan, she moved to Canada to join Tetsu. They lived in British Columbia, first on Vancouver Island and then on Salt Spring Island, where they worked very hard at farming and domestic labor to earn enough money for their own lives and for their families in Japan. Now, this story, so far, maps very neatly onto conventional general narratives of Japanese migration and settlement in Canada in the early 20th century. As that story goes, Japanese people, primarily working-class men, had started moving to Canada and settling there in the late 19th century. By the early 20th century, there were growing Japanese-Canadian communities, clustered especially on the Pacific coast and islands of British Columbia, like Vancouver Island and Salt Spring Island. There, Japanese workers tended to concentrate in crucial industries, fishing and canning, mining, lumbering, and farming, for example, as well as providing services like restaurants and stores. They also faced intensive racism, interpersonal and everyday, but also institutionalized, systemic, and structural. This included, for example, legal forms of discrimination like disenfranchisement, the removal of voting rights in British Columbia in 1895, which meant they also lost the right to vote at the federal level. By the early 20th century, there was also a significant movement of anti-Asian organizing concentrated in British Columbia, as well as the west coast of the United States. Organizations like the Asiatic Exclusion League included people who held formal political power, like the then mayor of Vancouver, Alexander Bethune, as well as so-called ordinary people. These people and organizations called on the Canadian government to create legislation that would restrict or totally exclude the further immigration of Asian people to Canada. And they made these calls in a variety of ways, including rallies. One such event, held in Vancouver on the 7th of September 1907, boiled over into a now well-known race riot in which a large mob attacked first Chinatown and then the nearby Japanese-Canadian neighborhood. The 1907 riot had many impacts, including contributing to a new diplomatic agreement between Japan and Canada, the Heihachi-Lamieux, or Gentlemen's Agreement, which starting in 1908 limited the number of Japanese men who could immigrate to Canada to only 400 a year. And this represented a major reduction. Approximately 8,000 Japanese men had moved to Canada in the first 10 months of 1907 alone. But this gentleman's agreement was gendered, a point that's particularly crucial to understanding Kyo's marriage to Tetsu and her immigration to Canada in 1913. Put simply, the 1908 agreement did not apply to Japanese women. But instead, between 1908 and 1928, Japanese women, like Kyo, could move to Canada if they were married to men, like Tetsu, in Canada. This resulted in a system of photograph marriage, in which families and communities would organize marriages across the Pacific Ocean, through which men in Canada and women in Japan would exchange photographs through the post, the marriage would be conducted over distance, and then the women, often called picture brides, would move to join their new husbands, many, like Tetsu and Kyo, never having met each other in person before. This period of significant picture bride migration ended in 1928 when a revision to the Gentlemen's Agreement further restricted Japanese immigration to Canada to only 150 people per year, including women. Now, women's experiences of these marriages ranged widely. In her 1972 interview, Kyo described Tetsu as, quote, very nice. But their relationship was not one of affection or sexual matters, as she put it. It was also fairly short-lived. After 5 years, Tetsu became ill and returned to Japan for treatment, unfortunately dying almost immediately after his arrival. Before I turn to explain what Kyo did next, I want to pause here to underscore that Kyo's early story in Canada is representative of the community's history in many ways, reflecting broader patterns and illuminating these structures that shaped the very possibilities of immigration, marriage, settlement, and work in early 20th century British Columbia for Japanese women like Kyo. Kyo matters in this sense because she helps us to understand that wider context and what it might have meant for some women. At the same time, one interview also hinted at her hope that she could use her marriage to get to North America, where she could look for her father in the hopes of sending him home to Japan. And in that sense, we should be reminded too that women understood marriage and migration in their own ways, including potentially using these systems for their own ends, or at the very least, making their own meanings for them and exceeding expectations of them as perhaps mere wives and mothers. Okay, now I want to turn to some of what she did after she was widowed in her mid-20s. For one, she moved. Initially, she moved from Salt Spring Island to the city of Vancouver, and more specifically, the Japanese-Canadian neighborhood around Powell Street, or Paruru Gai, in the downtown east side area of the city. After several years, she moved to the interior of British Columbia, but had returned to Vancouver by 1931. Over the years that followed the death of her husband, she also entered into a number of intimate relationships with men whom she called boyfriends. And finally, she also became a business owner in this period, initially by co-owning and operating a restaurant. Later, she purchased the second floor of a hotel that she operated for a decade as a brothel. And it's this brothel that I want to focus on in this section of the lecture. It's particularly important for what it reveals about intercultural and intercommunity relationships in Vancouver, and for what it reveals about Japanese Canadian women in sex work in this period. Kyo's brothel was located on Hastings Street in the downtown east side of Vancouver, not on Powell Street itself, but in the general area typically described as the home of the Japanese Canadian community in the city. But in this period, it was also very diverse, far from just a Japanese Canadian place. For thousands of years, this had been Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh territory, including a summer settlement site just to the northeast of the eventual location of Keogh's Hotel. Although decades of intensive colonial government policy and non-Indigenous settlement in the region had forced dislocation and disruption for Indigenous people, they absolutely continued to be present in the neighborhood. Since the mid-19th century, this had also been the site of an important mill, which employed a diverse range of Indigenous and non-Indigenous workers. The local Japanese Canadian community grew up around the mill site. That neighborhood also neighbored Chinatown. Hogan's Alley, the center of the city's Black community, was just to the south of that, and within a few blocks was also the heart of the early Ukrainian Canadian community in the city and the early Jewish community in the city. Keogh's brothel was situated in and shaped by this broader context. The building's landlord was Jewish. She employed approximately 12 women, who were not only Japanese, but also Chinese, Black, Italian, Canadian, German, and French, while the men who came to the brothel were also diverse. In other words, for me, Keogh's brothel matters in part because it underscores that Paruugai was an important place for Japanese Canadian settlers. But this area of the city wasn't just a Japanese Canadian place separate from other communities, but rather this was a vibrant and interconnected place for multiple communities. At the same time, Keogh's brothel also matters because it's a critical reminder that sex work, while often pushed to the margins of the community and its histories, was a visible and important part of life. In the Japanese Canadian community in the early 20th century, it was certainly a subject of debate, derogatory ideas, marginalization, and violence. Keogh's own memories suggest that the women who worked for her lived and worked in precarity. But they also make clear that she was only able to operate a brothel for a decade because she cultivated strategic relationships with individual Vancouver police officers who accepted bribes in exchange for not shutting her business down. For Keogh and the women she employed, this was an occupation, paid work. For them and the men who paid them, it was a part of everyday life. It was one of the sites through which diverse people encountered each other in the city, and for everyone, it was a visible feature in the neighborhood. Finally, I'd like to turn from Keogh's interwar era brothel to her actions and experiences during the 1940s. The period between 1941 and 1949 is a crucial one in Japanese Canadian history. Following Japan's bombing of Pearl Harbor in Hawaii in December 1941, Canada declared war on Japan, and the Japanese Canadian community experienced dramatic change as a result, including Canadian government surveillance, regulation, dispossession, and forced relocation and confinement. This included the removal of all people of Japanese descent, including Canadian-born people, from an exclusion zone of 100 miles from the Pacific coast. Most were sent to internment camps, road-building camps, prisoner-of-war camps, or to work on sugar beet farms in the prairies of Canada. After 1945, about 4,000 were deported to Japan, a place where some of them had never even been. Japanese Canadian people were not allowed to return to the Pacific coast until 1949. Put in that context, Kyo's story once again illuminates and represents this broader history, but it also offers an exceptional case of a woman who challenged the rules, exceeded expectations, and strategically navigated the conditions in which she found herself. When the order came down that Japanese Canadian people had to leave Vancouver, Kyo decided, as she said in her 1972 interview, that she, quote, wanted to stay in Vancouver. So she tried to evade police by hiding in her hotel. Although she had working relationships with Vancouver City police officers, she had no existing connections to try to protect herself when two RCMP officers and one person she described as a, quote, city soldier, a woman soldier, unquote, eventually discovered her while she was sleeping. All of her belongings were seized and she was jailed in Ocala prison for a time. Now this story is already exceptional. We know that Japanese Canadian people were not complacently accepting of the situation or agreeing with their treatment by the Canadian government during the war, but most did follow the internment orders, perhaps seeing it as the most strategic choice in a context in which they faced significant state-sanctioned racism. A small number of men resisted, but we have comparatively few, if any, other examples of women like Kyo who tried to evade the order and refused it so directly. Even while jailed, she continued to fight back against anti-Japanese racism. As she said in her 1972 interview, quote, it pissed me off, unquote. And she recalled even speaking back to a soldier for his racial slurs. After 6 months in jail, she was then sent to the Greenwood internment site. Once again, though, Kyo challenged the rules and exceeded expectations in her own way. As she explained in that 1972 interview, she had a boyfriend at Greenwood, but she did not like being there, and by 1945, she did not want to be in a relationship with him. So, with the apparent help of an RCMP officer with whom she cultivated some kind of relationship, she ran away, paying money to return by train to Vancouver, 4 years ahead of when Japanese Canadian people were legally allowed to return, and she said, the first one to do so. She settled in Chinatown, building on existing relationships with people who remembered her and her brothel from before the war, building new relationships, including intimate relationships with partners, and finding paid work amongst the Chinese Canadian community. There is, of course, much more to say about all of this, but even in these examples, I hope you can already see some of the ways in which this extraordinary woman navigated life in early to mid 20th century British Columbia. Kyo Tanaka Goto was a Japanese woman who had grown up in poverty in Japan, moved to Canada at 19 as the bride of a man she had never met, moved to Vancouver after she was widowed in her 20s, ran businesses, including a brothel, tried to refuse Canadian government internment during the Second World War, and negotiated her own way back to Vancouver before she was legally allowed to do so. At each stage, she faced challenging circumstances, structures of marginalization, but she also made strategic choices for how to navigate them, how to mobilize her connections and relationships, to find sources of power and choice, however limited they were. I want to be clear, though. For me, this isn't a simplistic, romantic story of a hero, a woman against the world fighting bad and being good. I think it's critical that we understand Kyo as undoubtedly, undeniably complex. She was. But this complexity is precisely what draws me back to her again and again. Kyo was a complicated woman. Like all of us, she matters because she was both representative and exceptional, shaped by and helping to illuminate her wider context, but also making these extraordinary, unique decisions in her own life in her own way. Her interviews and other sources help to expand our understanding of the Japanese-Canadian community as diverse, complex, and intimately intertwined with other communities. We still hear comparatively less about them, but Kyo reminds us that Japanese-Canadian women were present and active. They included working-class women and women in sex work. And while her particular life and choices were unusual, her story also reminds us of a broader point, that Japanese-Canadian women were creative agents carving out their own possibilities in their own lives. For me, understanding Kyo in this way makes all the difference for how I think about the Japanese-Canadian community and its past. And perhaps, like the very best histories do, it changes how I think about myself too. Thank you.